I'm Jeff Contreras, and I'm host of Austin Cable Access show Therefore I Am, the philosophical show with the political edge. And boy, do I have quite a special treat for you today. For the next hour or so, we'll be talking to Fritz Springmeier, author of Bloodlines of the Illuminati. Fritz, thank you so much for being here today.
Thank you for having me. It's a real pleasure.
Your book has been out now for, actually it was republished, isn't that correct?
Yes, it's been reprinted twice. Yes.
Reprinted twice. And the title of the book is The Bloodlines of the Illuminati. What exactly is the Illuminati?
The Illuminati is the continuation of the mystery religions. There was quite a number of mystery religions in antiquity, and these mystery religions had councils that controlled them, and then there was a supreme council that operated from India to the British Isles that then coordinated all of these mystery religions, and that would be the today what we call the hierarchy of the Illuminati.
So the Illuminati is basically just an extension of the mystery religion system, the whole type of philosophy.
Yes, it was a way of hoarding knowledge and power to a few special people.
And how did they hoard the knowledge?
Well, when I say knowledge, some of the knowledge is pseudo-knowledge, and some of the knowledge is actually scientific knowledge, which enabled, for instance, Christopher Columbus to be certain that he could sail across the Atlantic and hit land. He was associated with the Knights Templars, which is one of these secret societies associated with the Illuminati. So you've got different types of knowledge, but some of the knowledge is actually bogus. It's just claimed so that they can get people to join whatever mystery religion they're trying to offer.
Okay, Fritz. Now, why are families so important in this? It's obviously, you titled it Bloodlines, and mm-hmm. that must have to do with the families. Why are they so important?
It has to do with how they pass power from one generation to another. It also involves the occult powers. They try to have full-blooded members. They believe that, at least the traditionalists within the Illuminati, which are the full-blooded members, they believe that to really be a powerful witch with all the occult powers that demonology gives you, that you have to be a full-blooded member who's got a genealogy that goes back many years.
So in effect, what you're talking about is basically generational Satanism.
Right, it's generational Satanism. And they have to operate also within bloodlines because of the way that they carry out their mind control. They make program DID, or what was commonly known for a couple hundred years as multiple personality disorder. They program their members with MPD, and in order to do that, you have to have someone who will disassociate when they're traumatized rather than die. There's three things you can do when you're severely traumatized. You can just curl up and die, or you can go crazy, or you can have the creativity and the disassociative abilities to splinter the mind into a multiple. And they want that ability. It's essential because the satanic rituals that they carry out, which are horrendous traditional rituals, blood sacrifices, requires a certain level of insanity and disassociative ability. In other words, what I'm getting at is if you were a normal, sane person and you had to participate in the higher level Illuminati rituals, you'd probably go crazy without without the programming and the MPD that they carry out. So the is absolutely essential that they maintain the bloodlines.
Okay, Fritz, now when you talk about blood sacrifice, what do you mean? Are you talking about chickens or goats or something like that?
No. Unfortunately, I'm talking about human sacrifices. This is, you go throughout the world and you examine the different cultures, and you'll find that human sacrifice has been fairly widespread. And these powerful families have always felt that they gained power and through sacrificing other people.
So you're saying that the blood sacrifice that we've read or heard about throughout the history books has never actually stopped. It's just gone into secret.
That's right. Correct.
That's very incredible. Now, Fritz, yes. In the book Bloodlines of the Illuminati, you point out that 13 families are in control of the Illuminati structure. But in your book, you list 14 families. Could you explain this a little bit?
Sure. They themselves decided that they would have 13 families, or really maybe a more descriptive word would be tribes. And it's my understanding that the reason why they chose the number 13, besides its magical implications, is also it's in mockery of what God had done. Because, as you know, there were 12 tribes, so in mockery of that, then they have chosen 13 satanic bloodlines. But in working with people that were in the Illuminati and helping people get out of the Illuminati, I've gotten a fairly good handle on what last surnames they use. And although there's hundreds of, say for instance, Rothschilds in the United States, most of the descendants of the Rothschilds have other surnames. And so when I say bloodlines, that's more descriptive of families. And there are certain families within the entire context of the Illuminati that have become powerful in themselves but aren't labeled by them as one of the top 13. And as there's a continual power struggle between everybody within the hierarchy, you have some factions that become more powerful, and as those families become more powerful, they deserve recognition of their own. So I listed the Reynolds and the Krupp family. Actually, I listed two extra besides the 13, the Reynolds and the Krupp family. Because from the inside information I had gotten, they were very powerful.
So what you're saying is that the families that are the top 13 families right now were not the top 13 families, say, of maybe 200 years ago, or even as far back as 1,000 years ago, that as these Illuminati families struggle for power within their own system, they replace some families with others and vice versa.
Yeah, I believe that that process is ongoing. But I also believe that beyond just having the 13 families that they have listed as important or the top, they also, in a sense, recognize the power of other families. For instance, Bill Clinton has become very powerful in his own right. So, or the George Bush family. So, although they are descendants of these 13 tribes, they in themselves now, in this time period, are worthy of special focus or mention.
Okay, Fritz. Well, we talked a little bit about the Illuminati structure. Could you briefly explain how this structure is set up?
Yes, it's a pyramid structure. There's two basic levels in the Illuminati. There's the anarchy level. In one of my books, I listed hundreds of satanic covens and their addresses across the United States. I mean, there were so many that I listed, numerous pages that I haven't gone through and counted how many hundreds of addresses of different covens. And these are very eclectic. And besides these witchcraft covens, there's other lodge systems and other things also on the anarchy level. Well, on the anarchy level, you can't discern any pattern because everybody believes differently. Then there's three levels within the anarchy level. As you know, there's three levels to witchcraft. And then the next level are is the hierarchy level, which also has basically three levels to it. Although within those three levels, there's ranks and grades, and above that, there are councils that you can belong to that have special powers, and there's also special ranks and grades above those three basic grades. But yeah, it's basically anarchy level and hierarchy level with three levels to each of those.
Now, how does this structure basically control, or why should we even be worried about the Illuminati? If there's just a structure that's out there with anarchy, and then there's the top structure that controls the anarchy level, isn't that just some type of contained system within itself? Why should we, as just normal everyday people, be worried about this?
Well, the general public, as you probably know, is not concerned about this, but they should be, because all kinds of things, all aspects of their lives are influenced by these people. They're the movers and shakers of the world. There's some disinformation out there that I need to clarify, and that is the misunderstanding that's common out there is that this man, Adam Weishaupt, which was a pseudonym, a name that he had taken actually, started the Illuminati. He did create a modern structure for it. He was paid by these families to create a modern structure. But he didn't originate the Illuminati. The Illuminati goes back thousands of years before him. And the reason why I mention this is that if we go back into antiquity, we will see that there were certain families that were deified as gods, like Pharaoh, Alexander the Great. Maybe some of the viewers don't know that Alexander the Great believed that he was descended from gods. Genghis Khan, who still worshipped in Mongolia. These powerful families believed they were gods, and they controlled through their priesthoods in these mystery religions the people that were subservient to them. They never wanted to relinquish power. They networked together, and over history, you can never find any point in history where they gave up their power. What they did is they did a lot of sleight of hands and went underground or behind the scenes and let other people become frontmen, but they've still stayed in power. You can see a lot of I give a lot of evidence of that in my Bloodlines of the Illuminati book. Just some everyday examples that I ran into is, as a boy, you know, I met Henry Cabot Lodge. And someone who would read American history would know about John Cabot exploring the United States, which was of the Italian Caboto family. This is an ancient family. And yet you can see their influence in history all down through the years. Recently there was a book, Holy Blood, Holy Grail. Well, I say recent, it's not been recent, but it became a bestseller. And then the authors made a trilogy of books, Messianic Legacy and The Temple and the Lodge, and Pageant and Lay and Lincoln were the authors of that trilogy of books, and they go in and discuss how all of the royalty and aristocrats of Europe are descended from one single bloodline. Now, of course, then when you go to look at our presidents, you find that 11 of our presidents, at least 11, are part of that bloodline.
At least 11 presidents are descendants from European royalty.
Of the, right, the Merovingian dynasty, at least 11. And a man recently, you may have heard of him,
yes,
says that he has the genealogy charts to show that all of our presidents were related. I have, in the talks that I've given in the last couple of days here in Austin, I showed a genealogy chart that I have, which shows 12 of the American presidents very closely related.
Okay, Fritz. Well, you talked about how these Illuminati families, when they have power and we can see that, then they go into hiding. Most people would say that the Templars, the Knights Templars, were one of these Illuminati structures. Could you explain basically how they supposedly went into hiding? Because you hear about the Templars, they had quite a long reign, and then the French turned against them, and then they were outlawed by the Pope, and then they just disappeared out of history.
Right, and but they didn't. Although the Pope outlawed them, they were able to flee, and initially they went to places in Spain and Portugal, and from there they boarded ships and they sailed to Scotland. And there was a decision made to give Scotland its independence, and the Knights Templars that landed in Scotland then in the Battle of Bannockburn helped the Scottish gain their independence and then became very prominent in the affairs of Scotland.
Well, you know, Fritz, I saw the movie Braveheart, and I don't remember them being any Templar knights in that movie.
Yes, that's true, but the movie ended before the Battle of Bannockburn.
Oh, all right, I understand now. Okay, well, Fritz, now that we know basically a little bit about the Illuminati and about how they structure their system, can you give us a little bit of the mindset of these Illuminati families? I mean, why do these families, these 13 families and other families, feel that they have the right or the authority to control almost every aspect of our lives?
These families, since antiquity, have believed that they were gods. And of course, they have been worshipped in many periods as gods. And they continue to pass that prideful belief down from one generation to another. They believe that they're a superior being. Oftentimes, when I've seen quotes by these people or heard people relate what they heard, you see that they refer to us as ants or cattle, and that's, they basically have the idea that they were born to be gods and rule us, and we were born to serve them.
Okay, so they felt that they were gods and they were worshipped as such in ancient times, but with the rise of Christianity and things such as the Inquisition and maybe even the Reformation, shouldn't the people of history have stomped all of this out?
They made a decision that they would use Christianity for their own ends. So they established churches that they themselves controlled, and they went behind the scenes and set up a lot of fronts. So what you see, for instance, as proof of what I'm talking about, is at the end of World War II, there was a commission sent around Europe to examine all of the churches and cathedrals that had been damaged by the bombing, and they found something like 80% of these churches had hidden occult altars underneath the Christian altar that wasn't exposed until they were damaged. In other words, what was happening is these churches were built on ley lines, and satanic rituals had been secretly practiced in these Christian churches all down through the Middle Ages and up to present times. These were sacred sites that the churches were built on. In fact, some of them were built on very sacred druid sites and things like this. And so the Christian churches were simply functioning as a front so that these people could do their human sacrifices and so forth in secret. And of course, then they became pillars of society with their multiple personalities. They could have a front personality that was the ideal Christian, and on the Sabbat, on Friday night, they could be sacrificing somebody, and perhaps on Sunday morning, they could be the reverend that was giving the sermon. There's a number of other proofs that one can, or evidences of what was going on. If you go throughout Europe, you'll see a large number of the churches had winged reptilian gargoyles put on them, including something that's really bizarre. They would have statues of people bent over how do you describe it on television? They're bent over taking a dump, you know.
And this is on the side of a cathedral?
This is on sides of churches
in
that were built, that the statues built, naked people showing their bare bottoms. And if you ask, why did these Masonic trade guilds build gargoyles and people taking an excrement, you're told they did it for Christ.
And the word Catholic itself means universal. And so they just went out into their areas and just absorbed all of the local religions of whatever land they were at.
That's very well said. There were a number of mystery religions that bestowed their authority into the Catholic Church. For instance, the mystery religion of Dagon which was the fish god, and the Pope's hat, his mitre hat, was the crown of authority of the head of the mystery religion of Dagon. Mm-hmm. So he at one point in history was given the authority to be head of that mystery religion, and the Catholic Church was a good way to also absorb a lot of the paganism, besides being a front for the more serious hardcore. All I'm doing is saying a lot of these symbols have histories beyond what the Christian Church thinks about.
Mm-hmm.
You'll find a lot of... for instance, I have personally, with my own eyes, seen a good number, or I don't know if good is the word for it, but I've seen a number of churches with the Masonic Knights Templar logo on the side of their churches.
Mm-hmm. And what logo is that?
It's a cross and a crown.
Cross and crown.
Right.
Okay.
It's a particular... designed a certain way,
mm-hmm.
and it's very clear that it's a Masonic symbol. And there's a lot of other symbols. I've seen all-seeing eyes. There's Catholic churches that have the Illuminati all-seeing eye, you know, that's in the pyramid.
Well, speaking of the all-seeing eye, our local cable outlet, basically who helps us put on this show here, Time Warner in Austin, their symbol for their corporation is an eye. Isn't that kind of funny?
Yes, well, it all ties together. It's an enormous thing to someone who hasn't been initiated into, who hasn't studied this, the subject is so vast and so incredible that it's really difficult to absorb. That's why I really strongly encourage someone to begin by reading the Bloodlines of the Illuminati book, where I have the time to lay things out systematically, so you can see that this thing started in antiquity. These people controlled everything back then. They never gave up control. although they have worked through trade guilds and the Masonic Lodge and other things, they've always had the power. They never gave up the power. But when this country was created, we thought that we were getting away from the aristocracies and the kings of Europe. But lo and behold, like I said, you know, I can document that 11 of our presidents are related to the royal family in the United Kingdom.
Boy, I tell you, Fritz, this all sounds so incredible, just like you said. When you were doing research for this book, how much documentation did you actually find which supports your outlook and beliefs on the Illuminati?
Well, I've done many years of research, and I was just joking with somebody that I was visiting this morning, because when I moved into my new house, I had been telling people I had 100 boxes of papers, you know, documentation, newspapers and stuff that I collected. But after I had filed those away and I counted, I had 140 boxes left. So a lot of what I have learned was because I've worked for years with people that are trying to escape the Illuminati, and they helped my learning curve greatly. They point me in the right direction. And a lot of information is right there if we scratch below the surface. But they realize that there are very few people like me that are going to be looking in the right direction and scratching under the surface. So, and they don't have time to hide it all. So there is an enormous amount of information out there that relates to these families. And I just am the type of person to plow through enormous amounts of information. That was just, I guess, the gift that God gave me.
So what you're saying then, basically, Fritz, is that the information is out there, and really all you have to do is begin to search for it. Is that correct?
Yes, I believe that a lot of the readers, once they have read my Bloodlines of the Illuminati book, and then once they maybe have read some of the other books that I have and gotten a basic understanding of what's going on, they're going to start seeing these things all around them, and they can teach themselves, and they can further their understanding on their own without my help.
Okay, Fritz. Well, let's jump a little bit inside of the book, okay? I know you mentioned, as one of the Illuminati families, the Kennedy family. Now, with all of their recent tragedy in the past few decades, how can you still feel like the Kennedys are major contributors to this whole power structure?
There's definitely been some power struggles, and the Kennedys have been on the short end of the power struggles. That's true. But after John F. Kennedy was assassinated, and his brother, Ted Kennedy still was an extremely powerful senator because of his tenure and all of the committees he was on and everything. He was one of the most powerful men in the United States. So that immediate family, you know, continues to be called by the news media as America's royal family. But let's understand that the Kennedy bloodline is far greater than just John F. Kennedy's family.
Well, what do you mean, Fritz? I think most people would, if when they think of the Kennedys, they think, oh, well, you had John's father, Jack, was it? And he made all his money. Basically, you hear rumors that he made most of his money through Prohibition, and then he made a killing off of the stock market crash. And really, that's when we start to hear about the Kennedys. Are you trying to tell me that they have a history that goes further back?
Yes, they have a history that goes way further back. In fact, the Kennedys are descendants from Brian Borrow, who was the first Kennedy, and he was one of the most significant kings in European history. So you see that they're tied back to royalty. In fact, John F. Kennedy's sister married into British royalty. So these are just not commoners that grew up in a log cabin. But there's There's something that I would point out to our listeners out there in television land, and that is that the movers and shakers do not become rich and powerful and then join the Illuminati. They become rich and powerful because they are part of these Illuminati bloodlines, and their councils decide how they're going to divide up such things as the drug trade, monopolies, and things like this. And so when you see these families like the Astor family go from being totally poor, and in a few years, John Jacob Astor is the richest man in North America. And maybe I'll use him as an example.
Okay.
Since I got started talking on him. John Jacob Astor came from Germany, from a small town, Waldorf. His background was being a butcher. He couldn't hardly speak any English. His English was broken. And he was the type of person that if you were sitting beside him eating, he might grab your shirt and wipe his dirty face on it while he was eating the meal. He was gross. He was crude. He's not somebody that you would enjoy being around. Yet this man who could barely speak English and who is an exceptionally obnoxious person, within a few years became the most richest man in America. Now, how did that happen? There had been fur trade for hundreds of years, but all of a sudden he comes to America and monopolizes the entire fur trade, basically, on North America. Now, how did he gain control? It's because somebody in the Illuminati councils had decided the Astor bloodline, which is a bloodline that goes back to antiquity, the name is a derivative of Astarte, they had decided that the Astor family, you know, would be given that privilege. Why did Bill Clinton become president? Somebody made the decision many years ago. A lot, you can look back at the things Bill popped off and said as he was a kid. He said, "I'm going to be president."
Okay, Fritz. Well, we talked a little bit about the Kennedys, and I noticed that another Illuminati family that you mentioned in your Bloodline book is the Onassis family. Now, as far back as I can remember, just out of recent memory, the only Onassis I could ever think of was Aristotle Onassis. And really, the only reason I bring him up is because we talked about the Kennedys, and they seem to be linked a little bit. Could you briefly describe how the Onassis fit into this picture?
Onassis was, again, someone like John Jacob Astor. His family lived. Aristotle's father, Socrates, lived in Turkey, and at the end of World War I, the Turks committed genocide against the Greeks, and the Americans had a warship off of the coast, and very strange thing happened. I mean, you have millions of Greeks being killed, but for some reason, this American warship sends a party of Marines ashore, and the one person they rescue is some obscure boy named Onassis. And the reason they give is because he had sold a bottle of liquor to the captain of the ship, and the captain of the ship had taken a liking to him. Well, that's a nice story. So then Onassis comes to South America. He lands in South America penniless, okay, in Argentina. But supposedly by washing dishes, within a few years, he's a multimillionaire, one of the richest people in the world.
From being a dishwasher.
Yeah, yeah. Some jobs like being a dishwasher. You know, you can see this kind of stuff in Back to the Future with Biff, you know. yeah. And this is what we're talking about. So what I'm getting at is he became rich because he was in one of these bloodlines. How extensive is that bloodline? Who else is part of that bloodline? I don't know the full extent of that bloodline.
Mm-hmm.
I know that
In working with people that were in the, or that I brought out of the Illuminati, most of the people of these bloodlines do not have surnames that match the bloodline that they belong to. Their only major connection, so to speak,
is when they are put before the Grand Dame, and
she is to give her approval as to whether they're accepted into the Illuminati or not when they're like age 3, and they're given a physical inspection, just like the Masons don't want anybody who's got physical defects.
Mm-hmm.
And they're given an overall inspection, and in that initiation ceremony, they will announce what bloodline they belong to. But then they will continue going through life with a plethora of other names.
Okay. Well, Fritz, after hearing you speak over the weekend, I think one of the best examples to help people kind of understand how the Illuminati control world events, could you kind of briefly describe some of the major events of the Illuminati-controlled World War II?
Oh, of World War II.
Right.
Okay. Yeah, I'll focus on that. I might just mention to our audience, I could go back and essentially every war that there is, I could go through and show how these families have created them, manipulated them. Well, you can look at the wall, you can look at Wall Street, and the Illuminati families in on Wall Street were the ones that financed Hitler to come to power. Also, you'll see that the Krupp family in Germany, plus a few other leading industrial Illuminati giants.
Now, you're talking about the Krupps that make the coffee machines. Is that right?
Yeah, I'm talking about the Krupps that make a lot more than coffee machines. I don't know how many thousands of factories they have today, but they were the ones that built the tanks and a lot of other, and the locomotives and a lot of the other steel works that the Germans needed for their war machinery. And these people were the ones, well, one of them said, "We've hired Hitler." So they viewed Hitler as their hireling. So American and German and British Illuminati financiers brought Hitler to power. So you had that aspect happening. And then the dialectics that was created that created the issues and how the war came about were also Illuminati family manipulations. And then the United States' entry into the war, let me point out something here. We haven't mentioned Freemasonry, but Freemasonry is the continuation of the mystery religions.
Okay.
And Freemasonry and the Illuminati are like a glove and a hand.
Well hold on just a second, Fritz. I mean, I know some Freemasons. I even work with one, and I mean,
sure,
he seems to be the most down-to-earth guy I've ever known.
Sure.
And as a matter of fact, if I even get to talking to politics too much about him, I feel kind of sort of that I even know a little bit more what's going on than him. How is he controlling the world?
Oh, he's just a member of a lodge system. We're talking, the lodge system needs a lot of good men at the base to support its structure. And two-thirds of the Freemasons don't go beyond the third degree. They're that financial base supporting this pyramid structure. But at the top, we have these people. For instance, the Sinclair family, which is part of the 13th Illuminati family, they were given, if you'll look in Masonic encyclopedia, you'll see that they're listed as having been given headship over the Freemasons, and that was something that was to be passed from generation to generation. So you'll see that these bloodlines are in control of Freemasonry, just like so many other things. The royal family.
family of Britain has been at the top of Freemasonry in the United Kingdom. So it's not that every Freemason is in the Illuminati. It's that this is just one more system or lodge or secret society that's controlled by them. And Freemasonry just happens to be, has been in the past. It's no longer so much the powerful tool that it was in the past, but it's been one of their most powerful tools in the world for carrying out what the, their agenda.
Okay.
So let's see. Let's pick up where I was.
Back to World War II?
Back to World War II. The reason why I had to bring in the Freemasons is Stalin and Churchill and Roosevelt, mm-hmm. who were the Allied leaders, they were all three Freemasons. And Churchill was of the Illuminati bloodlines, and so was Roosevelt. Stalin married into one of these prominent Kagangovich, if I'm pronouncing the Russian name right. He married into a prominent Illuminati bloodline.
Mm-hmm.
And in fact, you see in Russian politics that same family that Stalin was married to is still very powerful in Russian politics. But anyway, so you had three people that are controlling these countries, or at least are the visible political leaders of these countries that are all on the same team. And Germany and Japan and several other smaller countries that joined them are arrayed against Russia and the United Kingdom. And the British wanted the Americans to enter the war. Roosevelt wanted us to enter the war. So,
but wasn't Roosevelt's one of his campaign promises at that time not to enter the European war?
Right, right. Just the same as Wilson, before World War I, his mm-hmm. campaign was he would keep us out of the war. And then very shortly after he became president, he declared war on Germany. And it was such a trauma to my grandfather, because he had voted for Wilson,
uh-huh.
that he never voted Democrat again in his life. He had such a strong reaction. He had a knee-jerk reaction. He always voted Republican after that. But yeah, that was a campaign promise. But see, these people, they say whatever it takes to be popular,
uh-huh.
and then they do whatever they want, because we don't mean anything to them. And so, in going back and researching, I came across a book that was written which described aircraft carrier warfare in the Pacific in a war between Japan and the United States before there was ever an aircraft carrier built. And this book describes basically World War II. So this is rather amazing,
uh-huh.
that someone was already thinking this stuff out. And then you'll see that when one studies it out, that the American military brought the Japanese Navy over to Pearl Harbor and specifically showed them item by item how the Pearl Harbor could be attacked. And then on the basis of that, basis of those tours,
mm-hmm.
the Japanese went back, made up their battle plans. American intelligence and British intelligence knew of the battle plans. They watched the Japanese fleet practice for their attack on Pearl Harbor, and then Roosevelt, to make sure that there was a lot of losses. The day before they attacked, he had all of our planes put on the airfields in circles with their noses pointed towards the center of the circle, so that it'd be very hard for them to take off when the Japanese attacked. There was a lot of things like this that were done to make sure that there was a lot of Americans that died so mm-hmm. that they could get United States into the war. You know, I could talk for hours about how they created this war, and then how they kept it going.
Uh-huh.
The Illuminati, well, shortly after Pearl Harbor, President Roosevelt, and I showed the documentation in my talk here in Austin from the federal codes. He drew up an executive decree which allowed the Secretary of the Treasury, Morgenthau, to exempt whoever he wanted so that they could trade with the enemy. So these Illuminati families, like the Rockefellers, who controlled Standard Oil, and Onassis, were given the freedom to trade with the Germans so that they could keep the Germans supplied with essential essentials like diamonds for there's a lot of industrial uses for diamonds, including they were needed for the gyroscopes and the gyroscopes for the V2 rockets and everything. They supplied Germany with oil, designs for military equipment, and a lot of other things that had the Illuminati not been given that special privilege of continuing to trade with Germany during the war would have come to an end easily by 1942.
So basically, we had an embargo on Germany if we wanted to, but we just never closed the embargo. Or we just never kept the supplies from coming into the country.
Well, if you were one of these Illuminati bloodlines, one of these powerful men, kingpins is the word I use within these Illuminati bloodlines, you had the privileged status of being above the war.
Above the war.
The rest of us, it was a real war.
And actually, Fritz, I think I can remember from your book, as from the Onassis chapter, his fleet of ships almost went unscathed, is that correct?
Totally unscathed. They were never attacked.
How many ships did he have?
It was between 200 and 300 ships, merchant ships.
And he was he's from the Greek fleet, correct?
Yeah,
Greek merchant ships.
His ships flew the Greek flag. Essentially, every other Greek ship that was floating when the war started was sunk. But his ships went in all of the theaters of the war, the Mediterranean, the North Sea, and they were never attacked by either side. It took collaboration at the highest levels for him to travel around in a world war without anybody bothering him while he made millions, perhaps billions of dollars off of the whole thing.
This is incredibly fascinating. I tell you what, Fritz, we're almost running out of time here, but before we do, I would like you to briefly touch on, I know you mentioned it earlier, how the Bush family has been coming into prominence here of late. Could you give us maybe a little bit more of a background behind that family?
Some of our listeners out there may be familiar with the Order of the Skull and Bones, which is a chapter of the Illuminati, and that they have rituals with satanic undertones. One of the things that they do is lay in a pile of manure when they're being initiated and say all of their sexual exploits. yeah, I know. Satan causes his minions to do degrading things that they think, for some reason, because their minds get warped, that this is something great. The Bush family is related. It's one of those families that's related back to British royalty.
Mm-hmm.
And Bush was head of the CIA. And I think it's significant to point out, if our listeners haven't caught it already, they may have already noticed this themselves, but you had the head of the KGB. You know, the KGB has been running Russia and the USSR, and over here we had the head of the CIA, George Bush, who becomes president, and now his son is running. It should make people realize that, in at least,
that the intelligence agencies have co-opted these countries. But it's deeper than that, because the intelligence agencies are being used as a front for these powerful families. And there's literature out there that talks about how the intelligence agencies have been prostituted to these powerful families. In fact, KGB intelligence, a large share of their intelligence, is simply being used to spy on Western industry and companies so that they can take all these trade secrets back for Russian capitalists, or Russian gangsters, I should say.
Wow, truly incredible. Also, Fritz, I remember this also from your talks over the weekend. I don't want people to think that you're like the only person out there talking about it, and not just today, but I mean throughout history. I remember you mentioned how Senator McCarthy, most people think out there that McCarthy was just afraid of communists, but it's really, from your research, Fritz, do you really think that was the case?
No, it wasn't the case. I mean, I was like everybody else. I only knew what I'd been told until I started reading speeches and talks and things that he had written, and I was blown away. I realized the man knew exactly that there were these powerful families, that there was a world order, and he was going after these powerful families. That's why he went after the Bundys, and of course the Illuminati kingpins in our government thwarted an investigation into Bundy. He really understood, and so because he was after these powerful people, these movers and shakers, they have used him as a verbal punching bag. I mean, I've watched I don't know how many people denigrate his name, even, you know, in the last few years. I mean, you think the guy has been dead for a long time, they'd forget him, but Bill Clinton has used them as a punching bag, and then George Bush. So
the Illuminati almost use him as an example. Like, if you come after us, this is what's going to happen to you. Isn't that correct?
Yes, yes.
That's totally horrible. Well, I know we've just got a few minutes left now, for sure. But before we go, I wanted to ask you, Fritz, how can we, as normal, everyday people, recognize perhaps the policies or the agendas which are pushed on us through the Illuminati front organizations?
Oh boy, that's a good question, but it's also a big question. Well, you will see that there are certain things that are politically correct. And you will also notice that the world is going towards central control.
Right.
It's going towards globalization, where we're having the United Nations. You know, the United Nations was formed out of the League of Nations, and there's a continual push to have one political, one world government.
Now, isn't that just a natural evolution of perhaps human society? I mean, as the world seems to be getting smaller and smaller through technology, most people would say that would just be a natural evolution of our whole government system.
Well, it's definitely being pushed.
Mm-hmm.
And whether one wants to believe that's a natural outgrowth of improved communication and transportation, that's up to the individual, but it is definitely being pushed. It's taking a lot of money and a lot of effort to make it happen. And the push behind it are these global elite families that are controlling things from behind the scenes. So not only do we have political globalization, but we have economic globalization, and we have religious globalization. So when you see any kind of an agenda that contributes to this one world order, or as Ed Bush has called it, New World Order, or, you know, Hitler, who was also of these bloodlines, also referred to New World Order, that seems to be a popular term with them.
Right, I noticed earlier when you had mentioned it, you just said World Order, that you didn't put the new in there. Why is that?
Because it's not new at all. In fact, they keep using the same formulas
the things that controlled people back in ancient Rome, you know, where they had bread and circus, mm-hmm. they're using the same formulas that they used in antiquity on us today. And bread and circus simply means that if you give the common person entertainment and plenty of food, like the junk food we get, they'll be happy. And most people, as long as they have their beer and their football game, are happy.
Unfortunately, that is true. Well, I tell you what, Fritz, I really appreciate you coming down here, taking time out of your busy schedule to come give us an interview, and I look forward to having more talks with you in the future.
Thank you. It's great being with you.